Welcome to The Keypoint, presented by Keypoint Intelligence. We help you cut through the noise of data, offering unbiased insights in printing technology and communications.
At Keypoint Intelligence, we transform data into analysis, testing into tools, and insights into strategy. We provide strategic planning resources, including market research, competitive intelligence, testing, sales training, go-to-market support, and customer engagement to supplier and service providers.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It's Carl Schell once again here at Keypoint Intelligence with another episode of the Keypoint podcast. With me today, once again, my partner in crime on the IT side, Anne Valaitis. Let's bring her in right now. Anne, what's cooking?
Hello, hello.
How are you today?
I'm really well.
That's great. One thing right off the bat is this is now our third podcast together, so we're going to need a title for this podcast series at some point, Anne.
We have to be creative, right?
Yeah, I'm not even going to give any partial ideas. We'll come up with something catchy and snazzy soon enough. So you ready to talk about some IT?
Yeah, there's lots going on, so let's get into it.
Awesome. So as everyone knows, this is kind of the constantly evolving world of managed IT and cloud services. Maybe that'll be the title. I don't think so. But there's always stuff going on with IT, and here to help break it down is Anne. So Anne, let's talk about some of the new things going on with managed IT services.
Yeah. So, you know, a few months ago, probably the second podcast that we did to talk about managed IT services and how Keypoint is really going about covering it. Since then, we published a white paper, Managed IT Services Guide, so to speak, for the U.S., and now, to accompany that, we've published a white paper covering Europe, right? So Managed IT Services Guide for Europe. And, you know, generally speaking, the components of managed IT services are the same, right? For the US or Europe, and, you know, it's this mix of IT outsourced services and software if it's needed, and hardware, again, if it's needed or where it's necessary. And this could include the cloud and network integration and cybersecurity and unified communications and all sorts of IT managed services and software installation integration. We've kind of seen all of this, right? And they overlap, and a lot of them are offered by the channel and some of them aren't offered by the channel. But we really kind of dig in, you know, where we covered the US market, and we really got into understanding what some of those specific attributes are. Kind of mirroring that to Europe was much different, right? We're talking about, you know, this many different countries, right? A big landmass area, so many different languages, so many different laws and regulations underneath this umbrella. And it was important for us to kind of put a lens to Europe as, you know, deeply as we did for the US. So, you know, there are a lot of differences, and we go into this in this white paper, kind of how they're different between the specific US versus Europe, you know, their regulations, initiatives, policies, compliance issues, right? So I just want to encourage anyone that has interest in that, right, to learn more about it, to go to our website or contact your rep, or you can reach out to even me directly on that.
That's really cool. Yeah, I am not very well versed in what the IT landscape looks like in Europe. Obviously, sort of well versed in, you know, rules, regulations, laws, currencies, languages, all the different countries, obviously, that creates a different vibe over there than it does here with the 50 states. So exactly how different was it? Are you really looking at two different documents at that point, or is there a lot of overlap where things are answered in a similar way?
Well, that's a good question, because I think that specifically, you know, we kind of talk about the specifications of some of the offerings. That is very similar, right? You know, we kind of see that you could be offering these types of endpoint management, right? Remote management, you know, kind of classic IT services, whether you're providing computers and laptops and things that we are very comfortable in understanding with IT services. But I think what the differences are, to go into Europe and think that you're going to have a kind of a European strategy for managed IT services is not necessarily going to fly, because France is going to operate differently and have its own rules and regulations compared to Italy, who's going to have its own rules and regulations differently when it's compared to other countries as well, Germany, right? You basically the UK. So that's what ends up being a difference. That's probably number one. Number two is things like security, right? We hear a lot about GDPR. you know, the privacy and the compliance with making sure that personal information is kept separately, right? And that it is not used in any sort of manner that would be against, right, a user like yourself or myself or a company. Each one of those compliances are different for the countries as well. So it's nice to think that you can have a full strategy for multiple countries, but it's not easy to do, right?
Yeah,
it's not easy to implement. Yes, there's a lot of strategy that has to go in behind that. So we do go into that a lot in this paper and really kind of pull out specifically what some of those differences are.
Well, that seems very instructive and strategic. So that's really cool. Let me ask you about the US version and the European version. These are going to be standard deliverables for us once a year, or are we going to update it once every 2 years? What's our strategy with that?
Yeah, I would suspect that ends up being kind of the mother document, and that from that, there'll be child documents, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some subtypes of things, and we would look to update pieces of it, right, as things change. Europe specifically, like Italy, has very specific regulations for artificial intelligence now. It's just one example. So as that changes, we would update that probably from a blog standpoint, maybe even an article into the service itself. But yeah, I think that to redo the whole thing, unless there's some massive change that happens, I think it's more about kind of addendums, right?
Yeah, sure.
Value.
Hey, that's still very important for people who are going to take the time to read and learn. It's kind of like a living, breathing document moving forward.
Yes.
So that's
yes.
Great. All right, let's move along here because I know how busy you've been, Anne. And I know that you are working with the great Lisa Brown, one of our good friends here, on the process automation and RPA study. So why don't you tell us all about that one too?
Yeah, very exciting. And we conducted an RPA. Really, it's a process automation because it did include IDP or intelligent document processing as well. So we did this multi-client back a few months ago. It's completed, though, over 800 respondents were participating. You know, document process automation has been around for a good while, but all the sorts of factors that came with COVID and remote work and digital transformation, and then all of the new advancements in technology like AI and ML, right? Natural language processing, all of these things, you know, kind of created this perfect storm for us to look at this again, right? Because there's new features, there's new functions, there's new capabilities. There's a whole host of new vendors that are in this space too, right?
Sure.
All of that is like creating this growth phase, right? So, you know, we're kind of on the cusp of that too. And we wanted to complete this study to kind of get a sense of where people are, where they are in their journey, right? So important to see, are people piloting? Are they considering it, piloting it, using it? Are they expanding it, right? Whether that's IDP or RPA. So it was really important for us to kind of get a handle on that. And, you know, there's so much focus on things like security, right? Management of unstructured content. There's so much unstructured content created every single day. It's just mind-blowing. And
a lot of it comes from my computer, Anne. Did you know that?
You are not alone, Carl. Everybody is kind of faced with that. And by the way, generative AI is just creating more content. So you may just start something if you're using ChatGPT or Bard or something, right? That's just adding more content. And the whole method and kind of the value of this type of process automation is to be able to get to the content that's locked away, right? Do something with it. Make sure that you're being, you know, really mindful with the content, making decisions, right? Looking at better business outcomes, you know, answer questions. There's a whole host of things that go with this. So it's interesting to see some of the platforms that are now coming out from that too, low code, no code platforms. And all of this has just kind of come together now to create this massive growth phase. So we're really excited. As you said, it's done. It's completed. We're out here kind of evangelizing it now, just trying to get people to understand, you know, what we've done and for people to take a look at it.
Yeah, I mean, on top of this podcast where we're talking about this RPA study, I believe Lisa published a blog about it a week or so ago. So if you are on keypointintelligence.com, just go to our blog page and you can probably find it up there pretty quickly. All right, moving on. Anne, this is good stuff so far. Let's talk about the service itself, the advisory service that we offer through our info center. What is coming next to it?
Yeah, it's, I don't want to say the word groundbreaking again, but we are, everything is groundbreaking. But I mean, it's kind of inaugural, right? There's a lot of things that we're doing that we kind of haven't covered before. And one of them is we're going to be doing a market insights study covering managed IT services, right?
Mm-hmm.
So with the coverage that we have and the kind of focus that we have now in providing information in support of managed IT services, you know, we want to help vendors understand. We want to help them. We want to understand better also what they're doing, how they're going to market, right? How they're servicing customers when it comes to IT. So we'll be putting together that survey for the market insight study on managed IT. And then we have plans to refresh kind of the entirety of our security content that we have on the Keypoint website. So yep. You and I have talked a lot about this, right? Security is a very much a pillar within the managed IT services strategy for any vendor, any provider. So we have a good deal of really interesting, compelling information and content. We want to make it easier and really more inviting for visitors and providers and other people that are looking for this information from Keypoint as we work with our partners. So we're really excited to kind of do this. And I don't think that I'm kind of giving it away because I think we're going to soft launch a little bit in September, but we want a lot of this to be kind of live and available for Cybersecurity Month, which is in October.
Yeah, definitely excited for that. We've participated in that a number of times over the years here, and I think it'll be very interesting. Hopefully push some security-based content during that. What I would say is I'm very excited for the Managed IT Market Insights Study, which will feed into the Pacesetter Award for, I believe it's called the MSP Partner Pacesetter Award this time around. And we haven't really done a lot with IT in terms of our awards per se, but this is going to be a good one. Kind of push the envelope here a little bit and see who comes out on top.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of vendors that are offering services in this space. So we want to make sure that, you know, we're looking at it, addressing it, understanding it, right? So that we can kind of provide that back to the community.
Absolutely. All right. Toward the end of this month, August, the BTA is holding their, I believe it's their national event, as a matter of fact, and it is in Boston. And you're presenting, I believe, about unified communications. Talk to us about that.
Yeah, I was really happy to be invited to be part of a panel on unified communications and the market dynamics. It really was to better help vendors of unified communications to help dealers understand what their opportunities exist with unified communications. I think that unified communications, collaboration, even voice over IP has been around a good while, and it's not a new category, it's not a new topic that vendors and providers and the channel have been around. They've heard of it, right? They know it. In some cases, they've sold it. But what we're seeing now is kind of more of a push as we move through kind of digital transformation, right? And what that means to be on a digital journey and how organizations are then kind of expanding out their cloud strategy. They are looking at solutions like unified communications more. So we want to be able to provide what the opportunity is, right, for the BTA channel dealers. You know, we're hoping to provide this insight. I'm on a panel with actual UCaaS vendors, right, that are in this space every day. They're kind of, you know, providing this information and their technology out and then building the ecosystem. I believe Konica Minolta will also be on the panel with me too, right? So Konica Minolta partners for this.
Sure.
They want to talk to the dealers about what exactly they're doing. So for me, it's great to be there, to be on this panel, to, you know, provide this information, but I'm really excited to also just kind of be in the room, right? Kind of hear from and talk to the dealers as well, get kind of the temperature check of how everybody's doing and what we are kind of now in 2023 and what's going on with managed IT services. So I'm so excited to present, but I also can't kind of wait to absorb all that information too.
Yeah, BTA events are smaller, obviously, than a big vendor event or anything like that, but they are so much fun. And there's a lot of education there and a lot of it's strategic, informative, and a lot of it's based on experience. I think this could be an interesting panel, and it's nice that you're kind of the analyst on the panel compared to being, you know, on a panel with a lot of analysts or anything like that.
Yes, I agree.
All right, moving on. How can people learn more about what we're doing with managed IT services?
Yeah, I think we're really trying, you know, really hard with these podcasts for sure, right?
Yeah.
And give a sense of what we're covering within the service, what exists, you know, what some of our other offerings might be, you know, outside of what we do in the service, you know, that we do a lot of custom work, right? Custom projects, custom testing, all sorts of additional work that certainly feed into, you know, our insights, our analysis that we bring to the table when it comes to managed IT. I think that for us, it was so important for us to shine a light on what's going on in managed IT services because the channel and the vendors and the OEMs are so focused on kind of moving outside of traditional print and what can they expand into, right? What are these new opportunities and where are some places that they can, you know, maybe create a beachhead, right? Whether it's in their own geography or if it's a specific topic, right? Some specific vertical even, right? We see a lot of people looking at managed IT. Okay, we're going to focus on managed IT for education. Maybe it's just K through 12. What's going on with K through 12, right? What are their issues? What are their needs? What are their requirements when it comes to IT? What can we serve them with? They're already a customer probably, right? Of print.
Yep.
What else can we offer them, right? This is not a new thought process, but we want to be able to help and provide, you know, some of that, what the customer is thinking from that point of view. That's why we do so much primary research, right? And we're kind of always testing the end user community so that we can provide, you know, kind of what's their real objective. We want to be able to provide that back to the community. So all of that goes on the website. And, you know, certainly I encourage anybody to reach out directly to me, whether it's email from the website. You know, our contact information is all up there, but we're so interested in keeping engaged, and engagement, I think, is so important in this community. So that's pretty much where we are.
Nice. Yeah, I would urge everyone, you know, if you have questions about print or IT or anything really related to what we do, and we do a lot, you know, you can fill out the contact form on our website, which is keypointintelligence.com. You can always find us on LinkedIn, of course. Definitely posting a lot, very active there. And we love to have interactions with people. So, and this kind of brings us to the end, but I wanted to cover one more topic that's a little fun for us, because my son is going to WVU, West Virginia University, as of tomorrow. We're recording this on August 8th, and he is going to be a freshman at West Virginia this year. Your son, Michael, is going to be a freshman at Pittsburgh. And of course, Pittsburgh and West Virginia are major rivals. So this should be very interesting moving forward, Anne, where we will probably be, you know, hawking something at each other, throwing stuff at each other at some point this podcast series, virtually that is, but very excited for my son, and I couldn't be happier for you and Michael. I think it'll be a great experience for all.
Our next podcast is just going to be a rehash of
the football game.
Of the game, right, and who knows? It's anybody's game, but I hear Pitt is, like, looking super strong this year. Sorry to tell you guys that.
Yeah, well, we'll see what happens. That's why they play the games. Anyway, Anne, it is such a pleasure to work with you and to record these podcasts with you. We'll do it again in a couple months, I'm sure.
Awesome. Thanks, Carl.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to another edition of The Keypoint.
Listen to all of our episodes on your favorite podcast channel or on our website at keypointintelligence.com. Just click on the Resources tab to view podcasts in the drop-down menu.